Hello everyone, welcome to our channel DexLab Analytics. My name is Niharika Rai and in this particular video I will be talking about sampling and its various types. If you haven't watched my previous videos, that is on the topic regex, visualization and a series that is statistics, you can watch those videos by clicking on the I icon on the top right hand side corner of your screen and you will be directed to those videos. So without wasting any further time, let's get started. Now suppose that you are a researcher and you want to check that whether the average salary of the employees in a certain company or a industry has changed or not from 2019 to 2020, you will be needing a certain amount of data to check these values or this. Or you will be needing some cross-validation and you need to collect some data to check whether this theory is true or not, whether the average salary has increased or not. Now there are two terms involved. First is population. And the second term is sample. So when you are taking the salary, when you are measuring the average salary of all the employees in that company, then that is population for you. Okay? And when you are taking a part of this employees, that means you are selecting some employees and then you are just calculating the averages, then that is called a sample. So suppose that you have 50 employees in a company. Okay, so this will be your population and out of those 50 employees you'd say that I want to take a sample of 10 people and I want to check whether their salary, average salary has increased or not. So that is called sample. Now a sample should always represent the population, the entire population. So that is one condition you have to keep in mind while creating a sample. Now there are several techniques which you can use to create your samples. On one side you have random sampling. And on the other side you have non-random sampling. Now let's first discuss what is random sampling and what comes under this random sampling, and then we'll move forward with non-random sampling. So you can say that a random sampling is something wherein you do not have a predefined order in which you want to take out your sample. So suppose that we have 10 boys and 20 girls and you want to create a sample of the 10. So there is no order in this particular thing, and it can be, there can be like 4 boys and 6 girls, there can be 6 boys and 4 girls, and that too you do not have an option to select particular boys and particular girls. So that is called random sampling, when you do not have a standard order which you need to follow when creating a sample. That is called random sampling, wherein you do not have a bias towards a certain category. Suppose that if in any case I wanted more of boys and less of girls, then that would create a bias towards girls in particular. So that is why it is not a random sampling and just the opposite. So here again, the opposite of random sampling is non-random sampling. Now there are several types of random samplings which we are going to discuss here. The first one is simple random sampling. So suppose that you want to create a sample of 20 observations, and we have few blue dots and we have few green dots. So in any case, if I want to pick up only 20 observations from these many data, so what we are going to do is we are going to just randomly pick in simple random sampling. We randomly pick, okay, this one I want, like suppose that this observation I want, just a random, not in particular order. That is called simple random sampling. We do not follow any order in simple random sampling at all. The second is stratified random sampling. Stratified random sampling. So in this particular sampling method, what we do is that suppose that we have red dots and we have yellow dots. Instead of randomly selecting which data to choose, in this particular sampling technique, what we do is we take each group, values from each group, instead of taking random samples. So suppose that if I use simple random sampling here, there might be a chance that I might select only yellow and one red. But in case of stratified random sampling, I will include all the parties or all the categories depending upon the ratio in which they are. Suppose that we have 600 yellow dots and we have 400 red dots. So in that case, I'm going to select 60 yellow dots and 40 red dots, and then this will create my sample. So in stratified random sampling, what happens is that you select each and every group which is available. Suppose that in case we had a blue dot data as well, so this blue dot would have also been included in this sample. So stratified random sampling is including all the categories instead of randomly picking the data, which reduces the chances of exclusion of a certain category. The third technique is systematic random sampling. In this particular sampling technique, what we do is, suppose that we have again few dots, we choose the first data which we want to select. So suppose that I want to select this particular data. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, once this data is selected, I'll choose a k value. Suppose that k value is 2 here. So I want to say that every kth element will be included in my observation to complete a sample of 10 observations. So 1, 2. So this will be included here. then 1 and 2, this will be included here, 1 and 2, so this will be included here, and so on and so forth. So systematic random sampling gives an element of randomness by choosing the first data, but it also which data will be selected is quite random. We are only saying that k is 2, and now just select every kth data and include it in our sample. So this is called stratified random systematic random sampling. Now the fourth sampling technique is called cluster sampling. Now in this particular sampling technique, what happens is, suppose that we have a town. The town is not arranged in a particular way that a certain type of industry is falling in a certain area. So we have an element of randomness in case suppose that we have different kind of industries in this particular town. Okay, and I want to select random industries, or I want to since I'm using a random sampling, what I'm doing is I'm going to select only a part of that area, and this area can be selected on the random basis or on some other kind of on the basis of some reason. But the industries which are falling in these squares can be randomly placed. That can be any industry, and we are just forming a cluster of or taking only a small section of that town or small section of that industrial area, and then checking which industrial area is profiting. Suppose that the question is that suppose that the clothing industry is having the maximum profit, or the average production of a clothing industry is above all the other industries. So in that case, what I'm going to do is to check that I'm going to in the industrial area or in a town, I'll just select an area. In our case, this is this one and this one, and then in that area any industry which comes in will form a part of my observation, or my sample will be a part of my sample, and in that then I'll compare the production of each industry, and then I will say that whether or not the clothing industry is doing well or not. So that's called cluster sampling. Now let's get back to the non-random sampling part. As I said, non-random sampling creates a bias. Basically, there are several types of non-random sampling techniques which you can choose in case you want your research to be biased or something like that, but I won't suggest that to you. But yeah, we have sampling techniques like this as well. So the first sampling technique in non-random sampling is, the first one is called convenience. Convenience sampling. Suppose that you're a college student and you're given a task to take a survey of your fellow departments and check how happy they are of the facilities they are being provided by the college. So instead of you going department to department and asking the fellow students to click on the basically fill the survey, you instead of doing that, you take that survey and you ask your friends in the same department or in the same classroom to fill the survey. So that is called convenient sampling. So your convenience is that you don't want to move to department to department. Instead, on the basis of your convenience, you want to just give it to your friends in your class so that they can fill the survey. And that is why this is creating a bias for us. This is basically the sample is not representing the entire population. Instead, it is just representing your own department. The same example, the other example can be that suppose that there is a theory that the brand, certain brand, is selling best clothes throughout the town, but to check that, you are given a survey paper, and instead of going to all the malls and moving to all the malls, what you do is you just go to a single mall and you go there and you just ask the people who are there for shopping that whether the product is good or not, and then you come back and say that everybody is saying the product is good. Then again you are creating a bias, because you are going to the mall which is closest to you, that is according to your convenience, and you are just giving a biased result to the researcher, or putting out a biased result on your research paper. The second is judgment sampling. So in this particular sampling technique, what you do is you based on the judgment whether somebody is going to be for or against the theory which you have in your mind while researching about some topic, you select people or your sample. Suppose that if you think that a certain person would be giving a positive result of a positive feedback of the pizza they are eating, then if you only pick those people instead of taking random samples and to see on an average what the result is, whether people like the pizza or do not like the pizza. So in that case, you are just putting out a judgment sampling and again creating a bias. Now the third one is called quota sampling. Now suppose that you want to check that whether somebody whether the population enjoys the lounges and the club life and all that. So in that case, if you the quota sampling help is that you create an age bar that is 50. If you are for if you are in case, say that if you're for the clubs and pubs, you might choose people less than 50, because you can, according to your judgment, it can be that below 50 people love bars and lounges, so that you can just go ahead and fill in your research with all the positive response. And in case if you are against these places, then what you can do is you can select people above 50. I am not saying that I am judgmental. People above 50 can also be liking the clubs and lounges, but it is just that it is a hypothetical example, that in case you have that judgment, you like to keep a quota, that if you want positive responses, you go below according to your judgment, and if you want against the cause judgments or observations, you go above 50. So 50 is the age bar or the quota. Above 50 is the quota, or below 50 is the quota according to which you are going to fill your research. So sometimes this happens that a certain age group likes something. So in that case, quota sampling can create a bias, and you will get results on the basis of your assumptions and your preferences. Now the fourth one is called snowball sampling. snowball, sampling. Now for that I am going to, for this particular sampling technique, I am going to make a chain. So suppose that you know a person, and since you know that person, you choose that person to be in your data set. So this is that person I know, okay? And this person now again knows two other people. This and this. So these are also included in the sample. Now these two people again know two other people. And so on and so forth. So this chain of people end up in your survey or samples in particular. And the reason why this is a bias, because you are only in this particular chain, people are selecting only those people who are known to them instead of unknown people or the random people. So the judgment can be biased in this case as well. So this is called snowball sampling. Now there are two kinds of sampling errors which can occur, two kinds of error that can occur during sampling. That is, number one, sampling error, and number two is non-sampling error. Is something which happens when the sample or the data you have prepared as a sample does not represent the entire population. That in case that there are women as well as children in the population, but you have only included women and men instead of children. So you are excluding children. That means you are getting a sampling error, and the sample is not representing the entire population. Now non-sampling error is something which comes up at the time of data collection. Per se, that somebody said that they have two children and you mentioned only three children, so you are creating a wrong data. So sampling error cannot happen in census, right? Whereas non-sampling error can always happen in census, जिसे हम हिंदी में जनगणना भी बोलते हैं. जनगणना में जब हम जनगणना करते हैं तो तब क्या होता है कि हम हर फैमिली के घर पे जाके हमारा जितना भी मतलब नाम हो गया, पता हो गया, किसके कितने बच्चे हैं, ये सब चीज़ें हम लिखते हैं. इन दैट केस अगर हम कोई भी मिस्टेक करते हैं तो वो नॉन सैम्पलिंग एरर कहलाती है. मतलब जब हम डिटेल या डेटा को सही से मेंशन ही नहीं करते तो इन दैट केस उसको सैम्पलिंग एरर बोलते हैं. और अगर हमारा कोई ऐसा मतलब अगर हमारा जो सैम्पल है अगर वो पूरे पॉपुलेशन को रिप्रेजेंट नहीं कर रहा है तो इन दैट केस वी से दैट देयर इज़ अ सैम्पलिंग एरर. तो सेंसस में कभी भी सैम्पलिंग एरर नहीं होता, क्योंकि सेंसस तो खुद में ही पॉपुलेशन का पूरा डेटा है. वेरैज नॉन सैम्पलिंग एरर हो सकता है सेंसस को बनाते टाइम बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स प्रॉपर्टी. So that is it for this video. Hope you like this video, and if you haven't already, please click on the like button and subscribe button. I'll be keep on posting further videos as well, so do click on the bell button so that you are always informed when I post my videos. Thank you for watching. Please take care. Bye bye.